streaming on YouTube as well. So I'm waiting to flick that switch. And a quick reminder for everyone, if you do want to share the link, I've tossed the YouTube stream in chat. Feel free to share that with friends, family, neighbors. They're working from home. There's not much else to do. But we're going to get ourselves started. We do have the Q&A open. We do have the chat open. Feel free to use those. But I'm going to get things kicked off right at the top of the hour. Daryl, Kelly, Christine, you all set?
Yeah. Let's do this.
Okay.
So for everyone, welcome to the Future of Sales Skills. Today, we're going to be digging into some of the nuances, complexities, and differences of soft skills, not just the hard skills like discovery and using Zoom and Salesforce, but you know those things that are a little bit sometimes harder to define and harder to dig into. Today's panel, we've got four incredible guests, and we're going to jump right into things to make sure we're not killing a ton of time for intros. So to get the intros out, panelists, if you could wave while I introduce you, we have Daryl, the CRO at VanillaSoft, Kelly, corporate account executive at NetSuite Oracle, and Christine, a managing partner at Dale Carnegie Training. A little bit of house rules for everybody. First of all, let's jump one slide. There are points for sharing opposing points of view. So panelists, please don't just plus one everybody. Let's get some different perspectives. And then a comment for the audience. Chat and Q&A definitely enrich things. I've got a great list of questions, so don't worry, I'm not going to run out of fuel. But if you have any questions, anything you want us to dig into, anything you want to contest, bring it up. That'll be fun. We've actually toggled the Q&A tool so that you can see the questions coming in. You can comment on them, so feel free to interact. We're very lucky in that we've got a couple of great team members who will be keeping an eye on the chat as well and making sure they get funneled over. For everybody, in particular for our team, feel free to share on Twitter and LinkedIn. We'll be commenting, resharing, retweeting, so we'll be sure to engage with you too, but feel free to argue, share our panelists' point of views, all of that online. And this one, I guess, is really for me. We're going to finish on time. So my promise to everyone is by 7 o'clock, we'll be wrapped up so we can get off into the races. So to actually dig in and get things sharing, I'm going to stop sharing my screen so that we have just our panelists. And to warm things up, again, we're not going to do the intros. Let's get to know them a little bit. I've got an icebreaker question for everybody. I'd like each panelist, and I'm going to go clockwise in the Brady Bunch order. So on my screen, I've got Christine, Kelly, Daryl in order. Yes. Want you to share an interesting or fun fact that you've recently picked up. And to kick it off, so you got something, we're talking about soft skills, social interactions. So something that someone recently shared with me that I thought was topical was that in Switzerland, it's illegal to own a single guinea pig. Because they are social animals, having a single one would be considered cruelty. So you have to have at least two. So I thought I'd share that and maybe reach the day. Christine, man, I know.
I rarely am speechless, but I'm really feeling happy for those guinea pigs that they're not one-on-one. But I was actually thinking about a colleague of mine in Tampa. His name's Rick Gallegos. He shared with us that it was okay for us to put a slide up with pictures of things we actually like doing. So I put up pictures of like card carrying avocado toast millennial like I am, local beer, whatever it is, but I would have thought that was vain. And actually it's been a great way to build rapport to show some of those pictures up on the screen when you're kicking off a presentation. It's been great.
I love that. That's a great one. Kelly, what about you? What can you share with us?
So I have a Zoom hack, which everyone may already know, but if people are dialing in through their phones, you can go through and get the phone number. Because I'm not calling people on their cell phones so much anymore. I'm like a big texter and impromptu phone calls. All these scheduled calls have been really hard for us to build the rapport that we normally would. But I also have a plant hack, which is not so related, more like the guinea pig vein. I was like very proud of how well I was growing my basil plant. It started to flower. And I was like, oh my gosh, look how pretty all these flowers are. My neighbor comes over and she says, it's not going to produce any more basil. Once it starts flowering, the plant is not going to be edible anymore. It doesn't grow the leaves for eating anymore. Mm-hmm. And so I think that is kind of interesting in terms of like how you're cultivating your patch and how you're interacting. Like you have to be watering and, you know, growing the plant, but also you have to be trimming it to make sure you're efficient with the yield.
Wow. This is awesome. We've got some Zoom techniques. We've got plant care, some animal care. Daryl, enlighten us. What else do we need to know?
Okay, so this is in the piece of trivia that you'll never use again, but I like it, so here we go. I'm Canadian. If you haven't figured that out, you will quickly with my out and about. It's going to happen, all right? So why does that matter? Here's your fun little fact piece of trivia. Canadians say sorry so much that we actually passed a law in 2009 that declares that an apology cannot be used as evidence as admission of guilt. There you go.
Love it.
And we probably said sorry when we passed it. Just one more thing.
But at least we're consistent and on brand, right? We'll go with that.
There you go.
Okay, digging in, soft skills. That's gotta be the fastest intro to a panel I've had. Thanks everyone, this is fantastic. I've got a couple of questions that I'm gonna go around Robin. A little bit to share, kind of your background, but also perspective. Christine, I'm going to start with you. You've got this rich experience at Dale Carnegie, and we're talking about soft sales skills, and it would be easy to assume that we've got only a tech bias here, because we've got a couple of people from tech companies. So maybe you can help our audience. Tell us a bit about the range of industries you've had a chance to work with.
Yeah, thanks, Joseph. And by the way, thanks for having us on the panel tonight. We're all really excited to be here, and thank you to everyone for joining us. A lot of other things you could be doing right now besides watching this. So we're glad that you're here. And certainly in the 14 years I've been doing this, we've been working with just in our local office about 800 different kinds of companies. But what I'm seeing the most are companies who have like a more technical person. So someone who went to school for something not sales related, maybe they're an engineer or maybe they are in the cruise industry. And now they're needing to add, as you said, Joseph, the air quotes, soft skills to be able to be even more effective when it comes to selling. So I would say right now, surprisingly in COVID, our clients have ranged from a fire sprinkler company doing statewide service to some of the name brands you'd know in cruising, or even a power origination company. So it really, everyone's noticing that they need to make an investment in the way we sell because things have changed. And we're hearing that they're not going back to the way that they were before. So it's time to step it up.
Nice. Those are some great comments. What a fun variety of companies to work with. Thank you for sharing.
I love it. It's a great time.
Daryl, kind of similarly, focusing a little bit more on that experience question. You've been a keynote speaker. You've run your own company. You work in sales tech. So you see how things have been evolving in sales over the last few years. Is there something you could share that's changed that maybe surprised you?
Okay, I want to, before I answer the question, Christine, Kelly, did you see what he just did there? He said the experience thing. I mean, I need to touch base. Did he just call me old? Just help me,
Wise. We're going to go with wise.
Christine, you're awesome. Thank you so much. That's great. Okay, I can answer this question. What has changed that surprised me? Simple answer, and it still to this day rocks my world, is that historically, sales and marketing, dogs and cats, they hate each other, all right? It's like polar opposites, Mars and Venus. That's history. Now, sales reps are freaking marketers themselves. When I have a sales rep reaching out to me and saying, dude, your subject line sucks. This is way too long to read. I have an 87% open rate, and by the way, useless stat, but whatever. And I can help you if you want. I'm a rock star, and this is a sales development rep. I never thought I would see the day. So the line between sales and marketing is massively blurring, as is where does the tech stack stop and start? That's the biggest thing I've seen change in 5 years. 5 years ago, marketing automation was huge, but now we have sales engagement. So when is, who's nurturing whom, and when does that end, and when does that start? That blurring of the lines, dramatic shift. They're becoming friends almost, and this is weird.
I mean, don't go that far. They can't be friends.
I know, but it's weird.
Yeah, true.
So I love the tee up there around the blurring of the lines, building a friendship, that idea of the softer side of the relationship is so key. Kelly, I've got a related one for you. I know we've chatted in the past about your travel, your writing, you're an investor, DJ. If we think about soft skills, is there a hobby, a number one hobby that's made a difference in your work, professional life?
Yeah, I like to make it fun. And I think people enjoy buying from someone, like when they experience having fun in the process. I sell accounting software, so it's not the sexiest thing that you can sell. So I think that I would say, like, storytelling is a really important part of anything that you do. And in particular, if you're going to be in sales. And so I did some stand-up comedy when I was in college. And every once in a while, when, you know, there is an opportunity, I'll do it. And then I also participated in, like, the Moth storytelling competitions quite often. And I think that learning how to tell stories in an effective way in that format, either in like a stand-up format or in the Moth storytelling, helps with a couple of things. It helps you with your public speaking, with your mannerisms and how you present a concept. It helps you get over rejection, especially if it's in the comedy vein or even in storytelling, like you are reading the audience, and it is hard now over Zoom, but it's definitely good practice doing it when you can in front of a big room. And then you also get to create concepts that are memorable and interesting, and you can visualize through creative storytelling and visual descriptions. I think that that skill in my hobby world has really helped me translate explaining a customer story to somebody or feature to someone in a way that is more interesting and memorable.
Nice, that's a great one. I also love the fact that I'm seeing everyone here participating in the chat as well. It's giving you some notes, because heads up, at the end, I'm going to ask each of you, what's one big takeaway you've had from the conversation? So those notes will help, I guess. That's good. Hopping in, soft skills. Now, let's dig right into it. I'll open this up to anybody who wants to chime in or jump in. Would love to say, if someone wanted to give a definition or an example or two of those soft skills, you work with so many sales reps, all of you. When you think about those top soft skills, what are the ones that come to mind? What are the big ones?
Well, I'll just share that when I started with Dale Carnegie almost 14 years ago, it was pretty obvious what a hard skill and a soft skill was. And we were really working hard to position Dale Carnegie, whether it was sales training or some of the other competencies we work on, like leadership and public speaking, as not soft, right? And I think we finally arrived, because definitely the line has blurred between hard skills and soft skills. But historically speaking, we used to think of soft skills as things like EQ or listening, our people skills. But as we're probably going to explore together on this call, the future of sales looks really different. And those softer skills have certainly become more of a hard skill that we can expect in our people as well. And truly something that we can be developing. It used to be that soft skills were things that people innately had, was the perception, versus something that can be developed. And we're finding that through our research and our experience, 110 years, that this is actually something that you can develop in someone, their softer skills.
What else? I love the way you teed that up. I see Kelly and Daryl chiming in. I'm going to put a pin in that one about it's something you can develop. I'm going to come back to that. Daryl, it sounds like you got something to riff on there. Can you?
I do. I mean, your question was, you know, what examples come to mind, as well as how do you define it? I totally agree with Christine's definition. What comes to mind for me, and this is where the experience comes in, I've been around a little longer, I've seen a little more, is the whole soft skill of conversation. Is incredible. I'm looking for, here we go. Okay, this is what I'm used to. All the conversation takes place here. And when you actually interview somebody or say, okay, you have to do a cold call to a prospect. And if I hear a real stilted conversation because it's so foreign to them, that's a brilliant example of a soft skill that I look for every single time. Because at the end of the day, whether you're selling face-to-face, on the phone, on email, on social, whatever, it's all about a relationship. And to have a relationship, you got to be able to have the art of the conversation.
Nice. Some wonderful comments there in chat as well. Arthur, great point there about building your EQ helps you be a better storyteller. And so I think there's some, you know, clear opportunities to build those as they interact. Daryl, you teed it up for different people have different skills. I'd like to think about it from a different lens, though. If we're working different deals, do we need to use different soft skills? I'd love to bounce that to Kelly, because I've seen you work deals of all sizes. So, you know, do you use different soft skills, same ones? How do you think about it that way?
Yeah, I think it really depends on, like, I've worked with emerging companies and then also more in the enterprise space. And certainly, like, you have a similar skill set in how you go about it. But I think the real difference is in how you think about the ecosystem of the environment you're selling into and how you rally your team internally and with the customer. And this is very different. If you're selling to a small company where it's one power user or two power users and a very single threaded buying cycle, then you have the you often have the habit of getting single threaded, talking to your coach, having your coach give you input, and then relying on that input to forecast your deal and then eventually close. And maybe that works in small deals. With bigger deals, it's a lot more committee driven decision making. And therefore, I think that as the leader in the sales process, you have to really map out whose skills match against who else's skills. And so I think the soft skill for you is really in the EQ space of getting this person is really into bicycling, and who on my team can relate on bicycling, or this person is French, and who on my team is French, or who in my customer sphere is a relatable person for them to meet with, that not only can talk about the benefits of our product and how it can be used, but also potentially relate to them in a way that is a little bit more personal. And it's very seamless if you know from the higher level what all the teams are and what their interests are and what their skills are, to match them with an appropriate person, that will just be a lot more seamless. And I think leading bigger deals, you have to be much more conscious of committee-driven decisions and gaining buy-in from a larger group.
I like that idea. Greater awareness. You tossed something in the chat there about learning to be likable as kind of learning a sales skill. I can't let that run by in the chat. Can you help us understand what did you mean by that, and how did you work on that? That's interesting.
I have a degree in sales, which is a weird thing to get a degree in. So I learned a lot of the Dale Carnegie method on the hard skills. That was what my courses were. I was in a competition. That's how NetSuite found me, as I was selling NetSuite in a collegiate competition. And we have a checklist, and it's you have to get through BANT. You have to get through the sale and the demo and all this stuff. And I was the best at it in the competition, but I didn't win the competition. I lost because I wasn't very likable. I was very focused on get to BANT, get to decision, show the demo, negotiate pricing, get all the points that you need for the competition. Then I realized the judges of the competition don't know how the rules work. They just care about there's recruiters. They just care about who would they hire? And I was not. I was very serious and very studious and very about get the points for the competition. But that's not what was being measured in that competition or in real life. And so my first couple of years of selling, I really had to get in touch with how do I become more human and less robotic in my process? And that's really about learning the soft skills, because the hard skills you can master by practicing and reading the books and doing the workshops. So one time my manager said, Kelly, I get it. You're likable. The customer likes you, but you got to transform that likability into respect to ask for the business. And that was a complete transformation from where I had, I almost went too far actually in the likability direction without remembering to get in the middle where you can have respect and ask for the business in the right way.
Kelly, I love that you're leading us with so much vulnerability to share that personal story. And it's fun to listen to you, because so often we see the opposite. Most companies are putting so much emphasis on hiring people with all the likability and all the swag. I know I have a client that just before COVID hired a whole team of people that could work trade shows. Well, how many trade shows have they been to since February? Zero. So you model for us too, that we can be a student of this stuff, both the process side of sales and then the people side. That's when you become dangerous. And by dangerous, I mean really effective. But most companies miss nurturing both. I just think it's great that you're highlighting that for us today. Awesome.
Great anecdote, especially from that kind of the sales rep, the candidate experience there, both of those. What about the flip side of it? There's the other side, the hiring. Daryl, you mentioned that earlier, hiring for the soft skills and the EQ. What do you look for? How do you measure and assess soft skills during an interview, other than just saying, hey, I liked this person?
Oh my gosh. I set them up. It's a trap. I mean, I don't mean to sound rude, but I put them in real world scenarios, right? So for example, I'm assuming that when you're at an interview with me, I'm assuming that this will be the most prepared you will ever be, far more than you will be with a prospect when you're reaching out to them, because you're working, you're doing your activities, you're hitting your quotas, you're busy, busy, busy. So with me, we scheduled this. You had time to check me out on social, go consume my content, read the company website, go to the analyst reports. You should never be more prepared. So when I say to you something like, what are we doing wrong and why? And just stop. I really don't care what the answer is. I want to see a couple of things. I want to see, A, that you had the skill to actually do that research, self-directed. B, that you're a critical thinker. And C, that you have the courage, some might use a more colorful description, to actually tell me why I suck and where. And then D, to risk it all by even suggesting a solution that I, who am clearly a little more experienced than you, hadn't thought of. I want to see how you think. I want to see your ability, those soft skills to have a conversation. Because if you can't do that with me when you're the most prepared, you will never succeed when you're representing my brand trying to sell my product.
That is wonderful. What a great way to tee it up. I don't have anything to add to that. Christine, Kelly, anything to add on?
Preach. Yeah.
I think it's really a superpower that you can develop as a sales rep that is completely transferable. So I would say, like, being able to do the research in your call for an interview is exactly what Daryl's trying to demonstrate that you would be able to do for him in your role as a sales rep. But also, yeah, like how I got into angel investing, like I prospected the companies that I invested in and I said, what you're doing is really cool. I want to be a part of it. You can do this with mentors too. Like, you can get people to mentor you that would never really normally do that by prospecting them and asking. It is a skill that you can develop and then translate to literally anything you want.
So I love the way you teed it up. One of the things that we see, you know, with Yuvaro, because we run a tech sales accelerator. We're helping people get into tech roles. We talk to a ton of employers. One of the things we see so many employers ask for is strong research skills. And that's a hard thing to just check the box. You can't go through an online academy, answer the quiz, get the little certificate and say, bam, research skills. So I'd love to open that up. I'd love to hear, do you see the same thing or not? But also, how would you suggest someone grow their ability to research? What's good research skills?
Well, that's a good question. Kelly, I nominate you. See, I'm pushing him. Okay. See, that's how I did there. Hot potato. Over to you.
I spend a lot of time doing like social selling, and that's a big part of my brand and how I go about my sales as an independent contributor. And I put in the comments, like, if you have a scheduled call, you should be doing, I think one of the teams, it might be Dale Carnegie, even like calls it like 3x3, like 3 pieces of information in 3 minutes, or it could be whatever, you know, there's probably some hard skill associated with how to use technology to gather information to make you helpful in that interaction. But I think you need to take it beyond that. I don't think it's about knowing how to use LinkedIn. Like, there are certainly some skills you can learn in how to use socially available public information, but it's really about in your core, not being lazy. Like, don't waste this opportunity. You're going to have to do it twice or three times. Like, I win in the first call almost always in my interactions because I'm building credibility in the first call. I'm building the connection. I know a lot about the account. I can predict what challenges they're going to have. I can predict how we could help them. And when you have that interaction, if you're having scheduled calls, you have time to do this. You know who they got money from in the venture capital community. You know who their customers are that are also your customers. You know who their competition is that also is your customer. You have like 6 or 7 points of connection that you can organically bring up through the interaction because you're prepared. And if you do that, you will win in the first meeting.
I agree with you 100%. The only thing I would add is for me, when I'm seeing with our own personal selling, but also with the clients that we take care of, if I think of preparation, the value prop is that it's going to strengthen confidence in yourself, your own confidence. Like, think about how good you feel when you're walking into something that's familiar already, the way that Kelly just described it. We feel 10 feet tall and capable, but we're also demonstrating to our person that we're with that they're important and that we're knowledgeable and that they can have confidence in us. Something as simple in a virtual selling environment as adding an agenda to your meeting. Hey, the reason we're getting together today is to talk about these 3 bullets. Is there anything you want to add? And then having a slide that has a few bullets of your research about the industry that has nothing to do with what you're selling. That's the broader point of view of what you're seeing trends wise in their industry can lead into asking a simple question like, Did I get it right? Is there anything else you'd add to this? Which of these are important to you right now? And right off the bat, in the first 8 minutes, you're elevating the dialogue versus walking in and the old school, hey, I see you like fishing. Those days are gone, right? So I would say strengthen your own confidence in yourself and your ability to get things done, and give them a chance to feel more confident in you as somebody that they want to do business with.
Now, I want to, you know, Joseph, you said we're not allowed to plus one everybody, so we have to have some conflict. That's what you said, right? I have your permission here.
Bring it on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Christine's doing this, but I'm going to go to Kelly. I love what Kelly's saying, but I disagree with what Kelly's saying. She's not wrong, but I think it's an incomplete answer. And let me go. And then Kelly, you tell me how I'm stupid. And by the way, my wife and kids will agree with you. So she said, you know, we can research this. We know who the investors are. We know this. We know that. Da, 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 and away we go. That's the problem. There's too many sales reps going out there presuming that they actually know who they're talking to, right? So they're saying, oh, I see you've got this much money and you're trying to compete with this guy. So clearly this is what you want to do, right? And of course, it's based on what you sell. What you sell is leading the conversation, and the prospect can smell that a mile away. That's the problem. How do you get around that? Kelly's not wrong. You absolutely need to know everything she said, but to make that work, you need to know who is your target customer, and not just words on paper. You need to live it and breathe it. You need to have talked to a dozen of them and said, help me understand your day. Help me understand your challenges. You need to know how they're measured. You need to know their pain points. You need to know what keeps them up at night. You need to know their tech stack or whatever it is they have. You need to know the dramas going on in their office. You need to know how the election is changing their life. Like, you need to know this.
Yeah.
So that when you then go research all those facts, you can connect the dots for them, mm-hmm. because too many sales prospects are praying and spraying, hoping they say all these things and somebody reacts to something and then you jump on it. You've Carol, got to have that context.
In the chat, you're getting some sugar. So Rashmi is talking about how we need to be curious. And like, yes. I hate to tell you, but I think you totally plus one Kelly, because I'm hearing the same thing from what you both are saying. And like in Carnegie, we would teach, ask questions. Like, that's what we should do. So we do the pre-approach that Kelly's talking about, but then we take that insatiable curiosity, non-assuming tactic of asking questions. And as Dale would say, becoming genuinely interested in other people. It's you take the knowledge, but then you flip it into a question as if you don't know everything. Mm-hmm.
The best advice in the be curious thing is you got to go deep. Like, so most people will say, you know, we're trained, you know, hard skills. Why? We're trained that way, right? But you know what we're not trained on doing is going, why? Let them answer. Why? Let them answer. Help me understand that why. In other words, you're going deeper and deeper and deeper, because the problem is when you just go why, they give you that cursory answer and you think, oh, that's the problem. That's not the problem. Usually that's just a symptom to the deeper problem. So the curiosity's got to go deep. Sorry, Kelly, cut you off.
Oh, no. I was saying, like, I think you're right. We have to marry the research and the context. Bingo. And you're right. That was an incomplete answer, because I don't know. I've never done some of the things that my customers are going to use my product to do, because I'm not in that role. I didn't get a degree in finance. I got a degree in sales, remember?
Agreed.
I don't know how to do the things that they're talking about. So if you don't have the context and the curiosity to learn their, like, how they would use the product, then it comes across as really creepy when you just know all this stuff about them, but you don't have any way to incorporate into how it has value. So that is definitely a rookie mistake, I would agree.
Well, you know what a good example of this is if you ever get on a sales call and you watch the sales rep say it's a product, for example, and they just demo every single feature they've got, all right? That's a good example. They've done no research and they have no context.
Worst ever.
So on the research thing, the one thing I do want to kind of push back on is that idea of being too curious. Daryl, I love your comments, but if they're taken in isolation, somebody could take that too far. And Kelly, I remember an earlier conversation you had where we talked about what happens if you take that research too far. would you be comfortable sharing a little bit about that? Just because I think we've got some people in the audience who are cheering, there's high fives, but I think there's also some value in the kind of the cautionary tale too.
I think you're right. the skill to do your research is a superpower, as we mentioned, and it can be used for good and for evil, right? So you got to have that great responsibility like Spider-Man. So I think that in used in the right context, in the right place at the right time, it is extremely compelling. I have some situations where I see reps on my team, and me included, when like when you're losing is when you start to get creative, and you should be doing it before you even start. So the problems almost always happen like when you're losing the deal and you get desperate and you're like, well, let me go through my bag of tricks that I forgot to do at the beginning and just throw them all at the customer right now. And that is what we did in a deal that I was working many years ago, is we were losing the deal. And so I was like, well, let's find out everything about this buyer. And we found out that the buyer was a stand-up paddleboarder. And the rep, I was a manager at the time, the rep that I was working with on the deal is also a stand-up paddleboarder. And her husband competed in the Chattanooga race for paddleboarding with this prospect like 3 years earlier. And they had the same hat and the t-shirt and all this stuff. So had we done this earlier at the beginning of the cycle, we could have brought it up much more subtly and organically and built a really great relationship from the beginning by just like wearing the shirt or commenting that you like paddleboarding. And then you would have, you know, the information, you know, that they competed in the same competition years earlier, but you bring it up earlier in an organic way. Under pressure, that's not what we did. We'd be like, we're losing. And we were like blurting out, but we're so much like you. We like paddleboarding too. In fact, my husband was at the same race as you a couple years ago. Like, don't you like me now? Did not work at all. Like, we totally lost. But I think had we incorporated that earlier, we would have won, no question. And it has nothing to do with the product at all. It has to do with like building that connection, but not in a creepy way.
But you know, the funny part about that story, I love that story because you're spot on. It's actually a really good story. It ties into something I had happen today with one of my reps. My rep was really confident on a deal. They got the news today. They lost the deal and they were so frustrated. And they're like, oh, we did it all right. We did this, we did this, we did this. And I said, here's the giveaway. When they gave you the bad news, the email, it said, we last night made a decision to go with this product. I said, you still to this day don't know who we is. All you know is your one prospect, right? Well, I looked here and I looked there and they wouldn't give me anything. And here's my point. I said, you're right. You couldn't find the answers on LinkedIn Navigator. You couldn't find the answers on Zoom Info. In other words, it couldn't be spoon-fed to you. You know what you didn't do? What? You didn't ask them who the names are. Well, I tried. No. You tried. They shot you down. Done. Part of research is knowing when to push. In this case, I said, we're a sales platform. You're a sales rep. You're selling to a sales leader. I mean, we have a lot in common, you know, paddleboarding. All right, we have a lot in common here. You can simply say, dude, you wouldn't respect me as a salesperson if I didn't outright push you for an answer. Are you going to give it? And then all of a sudden there's this pause and they're like, you're right, I didn't do that. I said, you got to have confidence. And that goes back to the soft skills. A lot of it's mindset. And that's a big thing that's missing today. So a combination research means sometimes you have to use your soft skills to actually know when to have the confidence and the wherewithal to know when to push and know when to back off.
So this is a wonderful tee up because we've talked a lot about, I'm on a meeting with a prospect, I'm on a Zoom call, I'm doing my research and prep. We had a question in the open Q&A there that I think is a good kind of time to break in. Daryl, you and Kelly, you work with a lot of tech sales reps. So if we think about just that breakdown of a day, you know, they're going to be on meetings, they're doing research, they're in Zoom calls. We've got this one question in the Q&A about kind of that typical day in a sales rep. So if they're exercising those muscles, how might that break down in a day? Either are you up for kind of giving a take on that?
I'll give my take because people ask me this all the time. I think that you should... sales is not a 9-to-5 job. You are not paid to do a 9-to-5 job. Your compensation is probably going to be majority commission based, which means that like, unlike other people on your support team who are not going to be commission based, you first have to be sensitive to that when you ask them for favors and be like very respectful of their time and complimentary of their participation in helping you because you can't win alone. But I'd also say you got to work however long it takes to work to get the deal that you want to win for the thing that you want to buy or whatever motivates you. So, I mean, I was up at 1 o'clock this morning prepping a reference in London. And then I was up at 7 a.m. talking to a customer in India, and I do it on the weekends. If the quarter end falls on a weekend, like you're getting your business booked. And that is just like how I have decided that I want to participate. That also means that like, from noon to one, I can have lunch with my fiance and not be online, or I could take a 2-hour lunch in the middle of the day, or you could go have an appointment. I mean, you have an incredible amount of freedom and flexibility in your role, but you do have to have discipline in how you want to manage your time. And then an expectation, I think, that is, how do you want to balance your life and what is appropriate for you? And then subscribe into that. So that's not exactly a specific answer, but it's definitely variable in how you spend your time.
Totally. Daryl, up for adding to that?
Yeah, I mean, I shared in the chat, I'll share it here. The thing about managing your time, you got to understand a few things. A, everybody's different, right? So you got to be self-aware about when you work. Some are morning, some are afternoon, and you just got to know you. You got to be honest about you. And then the second part there, you got to know who your target audience is. When do they engage or not? How do they engage or not? So with that out of the way, how do you manage your day? Intentionally. That's how you manage your day. You time block. So for example, my reps might do 2 hours of actual outbound new business development in the morning and 2 hours of outbound business development in the afternoon. They're going to have maybe a half an hour on social in the first thing, half hour on lunchtime, half hour late afternoon. All right. And then they're going to have, you know, the other 2 to 3 hours of the day to respond and progress deals. Tell yourself when you're going to look at Slack or Teams. Tell yourself when you're going to do email. Stick to that, unless, of course, it's in a month and a quarter and you're just trying to bring all the deals in. And that's a whole different kettle of fish. But you will manage your day by being intentional. That hasn't changed. What's changed is the noise. And the problem is, what's changed is also who we are as reps, because we're also conditioned to this now with the next generation coming in, that they actually often don't know how to turn off. So there's another soft skill they have to learn, which is how to mute. So anyway, there you go.
Oh, this is fantastic. A couple of things that reminds me of, that combination of being interrupted all the time, especially if we're social selling and we're on our networks, we're getting pinged all the time. Daryl, I think you guys had shared a fantastic guide to prospecting and social selling. So we'll toss that into the comments in the description and into the chat as well. If anybody wants that resource, they can get access to it. Kelly, I know you write about social selling as well. So we'll share a link to your LinkedIn profile. If you're watching this on YouTube or on demand, that'll be in the description below. If you're watching on YouTube, click the subscribe button too, and you can do more of these. But that idea, that autonomy, having control of your day. That reminds me of a comment you made earlier, Christine, about building on those skills. So I want to bring something up. I see these in so many conversations. I'm so eager to hear the panel's take. And Christine, we'll tee you up first because I really want to hear your answer.
Got it.
Some people say, if you're a sales rep, you're responsible for your own growth. You got to invest in yourself. But then I'll talk to a lot of leaders, a lot of CEOs that say, if you take sales seriously, you got to invest in your team. I got to invest in their growth. Okay, so who's responsible for it? And I know I'm asking somebody who helps run a training company this, but is it the rep or is it the company? Who do you go to for that development?
DaleCarnegie.com, is that right? Just so we're clear on that?
Slower than that, Daryl. No, thank you for the question. The answer is the dreaded answer of, I believe, both. I mean, personally, I wouldn't want to work or recommend to my dearest friend to work in an environment where their senior leadership don't believe in investing in their people. And that's because I believe that development in any area of our lives, whether it's the gym or a family or a relationship or a sales career, takes maintenance. You can't just go to the gym once and expect to look the way you might want to look. Why would sales ability be any different? And I think maintenance should come from a few different things. It should come from our leaders bringing a consistent process that we're selling with as a team or representing our brand. But also, like, why leave your ability to do something effectively in the hands of any other human? And as my fellow panelists have said, we've got to live an intentional life. Our founder said, take command, like take on your life and learn stuff. And so whatever resources or relationships that you can bring into your own life, I think that's incredibly meaningful. And it's also very marketable as you're looking to shift around potentially in your selling career to represent different products or different services. So the age old both would be nice, will be my answer for sure.
There you go. Daryl, you had a great comment you tossed into the chat there as well. How much are you willing to invest? Can you expand on that?
Yeah, let me give you an example of that. All right. And I love this. I'm going to give full attribution because he nailed it. There's a fellow online. He's a sales trainer. His name is Benjamin Dennehy. He does a wonderful job branding himself as the UK's most hated sales trainer. So there you go. But he tells a story. And when I heard it, I'm like, that's it. And he tells a story where he goes in to, you know, a managing director or a CEO, and he says, we're thinking of bringing Benjamin to train everybody here how to be better on the phones. And they're all like, yeah, and it's going to cost us $20,000. Yeah. Okay. And there's 10 of you here. You each have to contribute $500 each. Silence. Crickets. Right. Why? So let me see. It's a $2,000 training, and you only have to pay 25% of it, and you're crickets. But you know what? You're going to bitch and moan when you don't get that pay raise, or you don't get that chance, you don't get that opportunity. You're going to lay blame why you didn't hit quota. That's wrong. That ain't how it works. I got news for you. You got to invest in yourself. Simple expression, learning is earning. You have to own your career. I'm telling you, nothing but platitudes here, but they're platitudes for a reason. I've taken jobs where I've stepped back tens of thousands of dollars in my income because of what they would teach me. And then, you know, put the long game in 2 or 3 years, move forward, and then recoup all that money and make a whole bunch more. That's just one example. Do you have the courage to do that? Is that part of your budgeting process, your monthly budgeting process? Do you have to defend that with your life partner for that investment? It's got to be a psychology. Again, mindset over and over again. How committed are you to your craft? I mean, think about it. You'd go to university and you drop $10, $20, $30, $100, $200,000 in education. And then you graduate and like you never invest again? It doesn't work that way. That's how it works.
Kelly, we'd love to hear your
story. You won't grow. Yeah.
You've been all over in the sales battle. So what's your take on that?
Yeah, I think what Daryl said was the exact same for me in my career. Like I had an opportunity at the beginning of my career to go into a role at a smaller company, at a startup, and be a sales rep and get paid much more than being a BDR, which is the bottom of the sales organization, but at a company like NetSuite Oracle. And so at that time, like I actually got some advice from my grandma who was a mentor to me. And I was like, what do you think that I should do? And she said that at the beginning of her career, this is a very long time ago, she went to college and she became a physical therapist. And she had an opportunity when she graduated to either go into building her own physical therapy practice or go work for someone else and learn more skills. And she felt at that time, I just got my degree. I'm like the first person in my family to go to college at this time. I'm going to go start my own practice. And she told me that she always regretted that. And she always wished that she had taken a step back, invested more in learning, and then she would have had a totally different career trajectory. So that is what I chose to do when I joined NetSuite in the BDR program. And exactly as Daryl prophesized and some other mentors that I have had many more opportunities to be able to expand on and grow my skills to be able to earn much, much more than I think I would have had if I'd gone in as a sales rep at a smaller company with less support.
I love the comments. I want to toss out maybe a challenge to that one though. Daryl, I love your story. You know, it's everybody, $500. But there's a great question in the Q&A there about hiring and diversity and inclusion. And if I think about that one, not everybody's in equal circumstances. You got a bunch of reps saying, hey, toss out $500. Maybe they're sending family, like money to their family overseas. Maybe they're dealing with a different situation. Maybe they've got other fees and debts we don't know about. So how do you balance that idea of a challenge with being kind of really inclusive on a team?
That's an easy answer, right? I mean, nothing happens without sacrifice in life. Admittedly, not everybody has the same opportunities. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting here as a 50-year-old white guy. I get it. But that doesn't mean you can't factor in a portion. Is it 1%? Is it 50% of your income? You figure that out. Here's the next thing you need to understand. We have never been in a more information consuming environment in our life. This course here tonight costs us nothing. All right. And then you can actually reach out to Christine and Kelly and myself, and you can pick our brains and books and everything else. YouTube, my goodness, it's going to be on YouTube. So in some regards, the answer is not that it's a lack of funds. Often, admittedly, it's a lack of time. So what's more important? Do you want to watch that latest episode of, you know, The Bachelor? Not that I ever watched The Bachelor, but that's an awesome show. Or do you want to actually go and, you know, invest some time in studying? And I get it. When I get home, I'm exhausted. So these are just conscious choices you have to make. And the other thing you need to adjust is it's a timeline, right? It's very common. Some people, they get there in 1 year or 3 years, and others take 10 years. It's not when you do it. No one's keeping score. It's the fact that you're committed. It's all it is. It's just a process. Play the long game.
True. Daryl, I think the chat's never been more active than when you brought up The Bachelor. A deal from that, and I can definitely relate to that. Sometimes, again, those personal things pull us in, and it kind of looks like you might be on the set of The Bachelor with your red curtains, so I don't know. That might have been a secret plug for what you're talking about. But
guys, do I get the rose? That's all I want to know. I'd say, you know, there we go.
Thank you. I love that. That's the idea. It's not just about the money. It's about that dedication and how you choose to spend your time. What a fantastic angle on that. So thank you. I'd like to keep the ball rolling on that idea of kind of the skills that people have, the work that I have. Something else was brought up earlier. So kind of rolling it back, there was that conversation about authenticity. And we hear that a lot from employers as well. You know, they say, hey, I want good research skills, but they also talk about being authentic. So I'd love to open this up to the group. Again, for anybody, open field. Yeah, I saw a lot of heads nodding, but what does that mean when someone's being authentic, specifically a sales rep? You know, anybody want to jump in and take a shot at that?
You know, there's two things that come to mind for me. I can jump in right here. If you go back with me to March of this year, the beginning of COVID, I was having a sales call with one of my sales training clients, and we were talking about how Mondays, he asked me how I was. And when he asked me how I was, I could easily be like, oh, I'm great. Everything's good. But I said, you know what? I've got kind of a case of the Monday blues. I don't know what it is, but during COVID, maybe I'm not meant to be like cooped up in this house or now my office all the time, but it's been tough. And it led to this really genuine conversation about some of the conversations he was having with his reps. And a couple months later, he came back to me and said, you know, I still think about that conversation. And it was one of the reasons I knew I'd hired the right person to do sales training for my team, because you're like a real human too. And I think sharing about ourselves in a genuine way is one way that we can promote authenticity. And then just real briefly, the other thing I want to share. So one of the resources that the Dale Carnegie Resources will be sharing today is a white paper that we wrote on trust, and it's called Trust is Dead. But basically it talks about how we all know what it feels like when something's authentic or when there's trust involved, but what are the intentional, it's like a buzzword from this call, behaviors that we can be incorporating in order to cultivate trust. You can read more about that there, but a big part of it goes back to your own attitude and your self-confidence. So again, having an authentic sense of self, confidence and belief in yourself is gonna be a huge attractor for people to wanna do business with us versus maybe somebody else.
I see Daryl and Kelly both nodding, but looks like you're both eager to jump in. Who wants to run with that?
I'll let Kelly go first. I've been blah, 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 nonstop. Go ahead, Kelly.
Yeah, I think that authenticity goes hand in hand with vulnerability. And as part of like my learning how to be less robotic, like Christine was saying, like being a real human was something that I had to like work on. And I think that as you go through that, you recognize in yourself, like you get your own self-confidence in who you are, and who you are is like a really good sales rep of whatever product you're representing, but you're also all these other things. And so is your customer. Your customer is not just your customer, and they're not just an employee or a user of your software. They're also all these other things. And you will have something that overlaps in those Venn diagrams. And it's your job to figure out what that's going to be. And part of that is from research, but part of that is from being vulnerable. And so as you start to talk about what you're into, like I'm growing my basil plant and I'm killing it accidentally because it's flowering and I didn't even know, and now I can't make pesto. Like that is a weird anecdote that I can say or something like that. And someone else will have something weird that is that's their weird thing too. And I think like owning your weirdness is very charming, and it displayed in the right way can make you very vulnerable, and it allows the other person to have permission to show their weirdness too. And you will find some Venn diagram overlap of your own weirdness, and that's when you really are going to shine.
So, okay, everybody should just go hashtag right now, hashtag be weird. Kelly's rocking it with that one. I love that one. I want to be the cranky old man for a second, okay? Can I be the cranky old man, Joseph?
Cranky wise man, I think, but sure.
Okay, sure. Let's go with that one. I think profit was mentioned earlier. Christine, I owe you money now for that. Thank you so much.
I just hashtagged it. So you're just,
there we go. It's great. Okay, so let's talk about authenticity, all right? Because it is everything that Kelly and Christine said is spot on. And I love what Kelly said, be weird. It's so true, right? That's part of being being who you are. One of my comments was stop projecting. You know, stop projecting who you think the other person wants to talk to. That ain't authentic. Be you. Are you comfortable in your own skin? Because if you're not, you're going to fail, just so you know. All right. And you should look for another career. Harsh truth from dad. There you go. But the thing about authenticity is this. And this is a personal opinion that I've seen proven out over and over and over again. Why are you authentic? You're authentic because it's your own personal brand. It's who you are. It's what makes you different from somebody else. I like that Kelly has a big passion for plants and that, you know, she's just got this house and it worked her sales skills and that she's all about being weird. That is uniquely Kelly. All right. And she's memorable now because of that. That is amazing. What it isn't, though, is picking up a phone and doing your best Instagram post because you're trying to project somebody and show me the money and, you know, yo, yo, dog, you know, and then because you got a crap, it sounds stupid because everything's video these days. If you got a crappy video, your crappy audio, and you say, dude, you look like crap. I would never buy from you. I'm just being authentic. No, you're not. You're not being authentic. What you're showing is you don't care enough about your own brand. Therefore, you'll never care about my success. Mm. All right. So that's one thing I want to be the cranky old man to say. You're conveying a lot through your authenticity. You're conveying why I should trust you.
So I want to dig into this a little bit because on the one hand, everyone's spoken about a number of things that are obviously trainable, like the way you use your video camera, the way you talk about yourself, feeling comfortable. So let's not emphasize that too much. But Christine, you started off by talking about trust. And then Daryl, you just wrapped up with that comment about trust, building trust. Now there's a vague idea. How does someone become excellent, strong? How do they train that ability, being good at building trust? Christine, you guys had a white paper on it, so let's start off.
If you grab the white paper, it's research-based. So basically, Dale Carnegie has done a ton of research. We wrote that really old book, How to Win Friends and Influence People. That was like the number one best-selling book after the Bible before 50 Shades of Grey, right? That totally knocked us out of second place. But besides that, we do a lot of research. It's consistent with all the other major researchers out there. But what we did that's a little different is what can you actually do to build trust? And so you'll see some great stats about how if someone has trust with us, they're more likely to give us referrals or they're more likely to forgive a mistake. Kind of obvious, like you said, Joseph, but the three main things that we find consistently are present with a sales rep that someone trusts is one, they've got that strong, like we mentioned before, belief in themselves and positive attitude. They're confident in what they're doing. And then the second thing is that they're actually creating value for people. So one thing we're coaching people to have is a point of view. Like, what's your point of view on fill in the blank, whether it's the industry that you're prospecting in or even your own industry? We can't just be pushing out content. We've got to truly have our own point of view of what we're seeing. And then finally, the third area, and you can read about it more in the white paper, so I won't go too far, is that reps who are customer centric are more trusted. Kind of obvious, but things like, are you empathetic versus benevolent? Things we know, it's common sense. But if you ask yourself, am I doing this or do I just know it? A lot of times that inventory is not what we want it to be. And then to the point of this panel, as my colleague Robert Kelly always says, you know, could I be doing it just a little bit better? And it really can make a difference if we start to just be more mindful of some of these common sense things, we start doing them a little bit better.
I love the points. And straight up, I need to give you the biggest kudos that you kept a straight face sharing that while Daryl and Kelly were talking about,
you know,
how to win friends and influence people.
In my eye in the chat, the comment about combining, but I'm going to untouch that one. But
I think it's a bestseller you could have back into second place. I'm seeing it right now, right?
I'm good. We're still the number one best-selling business book of all time.
There we go. I'll take it. That's great.
It's a sequel. You have number two as well.
Oh. Exactly.
This is great. We've got just a couple of minutes left. I want to kind of circle shift onto kind of one last question, ask you what your biggest takeaway was. This ain't the question's coming. And then I promise we'd get everybody out right at seven. So we talked a bit about the sales skills we're seeing now, authenticity, building trust, research, curiosity. What a wonderful list. Thinking forward over the next few years, we're selling remotely. We've got teams. I'm talking to give you some time. Would love to hear, what do you think is going to be really important in the future? Your teams or others, what should people be thinking about to kind of future-proof themselves?
I can kick off if you want, since we're going close. I don't know, I'm kind of inspired. I know, Daryl, you've been really playful about your seniority amongst us today. So I appreciate that. But I think my big takeaway for me from the panel that I hope we can really reinforce is, in order to really think about future selling, it's going to be a combination of the proven old school things that we know work, but then also that freshness, like Kelly, we all keep bringing this like freshness of us working right now. It's going to take a rooting in where we've been in sales with that open-mindedness. My founder said, you've got to keep your mind open to change all the time. Welcome it, court it. It's only by examining and re-examining ideas you can progress. So bring the old school, bring the new school. And I think that'll make us really successful in sales moving forward.
That's awesome.
I would say that the way that this panel is kind of kicked off in the description is like sales has a reputation of being a little bit like car salesman-y. And I'm even seeing like in my industry, I sell like a very complex product. There are some customers saying like, I know what I want. I did my research online. I just want to buy it. Why do I have to go through a sales rep? And so even with a complex sale, so I can't even imagine with a simpler sale, what kind of feedback we'd be getting. So I think that if I was to give advice about like the future of sales, I would say choose something to sell that you are passionate about, but that it also is difficult to understand, is complicated, because the more value that you can add, the more necessary you will be. And then second to that, I would say, I think you should find ways to add value to your customer in ways they don't expect. So certainly like they expect you to add value in solving the problems that you're, if we're talking about software, that your software solves. But I spend a lot of time with my customers thinking about ways I can help them in things they wouldn't expect that are not solved by my software. They could be solved by my network. They could be solved by my connections. They could be solved by my experience or recommendations. And when you start to solve for things that they don't expect you to be able to solve, then it makes you as the sales rep much more valuable to them. And it shines your product very well. It makes your product seem much more useful to them because you are the evangelist and the delegate of that.
Love it. Daryl?
One of the areas I love what Kelly just said, then I'll answer the question, but I want to really hit it. She nailed it. And she said, sell something you're passionate about. All right. So I'm a computer programmer by trade. Here I am as a CRO. What's the commonality? The commonality is tech. I love the tech. That's what made me successful and able to do my job. So she is 100%. Don't ask me to go and sell pharmaceuticals. Shoot me now. You know what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. So she is amazingly on that one. That's a huge point. For me, you said, you know, 5 years time. I would say it's even sooner. We haven't touched upon it. There's two things come to mind. And I think this is a sign of the times. Again, as we're there's a big election coming up and you're seeing what's happening. You're seeing a lot of tribalism. You're seeing a lot of it's not good. So how do you succeed as a sales rep in that? Two parts. One, critical thinking. You've got to be able to step out of your own biases and examine the situation without that baggage so you can truly navigate. But in tandem, empathy. If you do not understand the pain, the challenges that your buyer is going through, or your champion or veto or whomever, you're not going to succeed. But ironically, if you can master that empathy, then they will trust you. You will be authentic You will come across as vulnerable. It will help you do much better research, and you can use it to be very intentional. So to me, those are the ones, empathy and critical thinking.
These are fantastic. I don't think there's a higher note that we could be wrapping up on. I know I said I was going to ask for your biggest takeaways. I did promise to get everyone out by 7. So what I'm going to do is follow up separately, wrap them up in an email, because we have some resources we're sending out to all the attendees. The documents linked, the articles linked. In there, I'm going to include the biggest takeaways from everyone. We've got a little bit of housekeeping before we wrap up, but Daryl, Kelly, Christine, this has been awesome. This has been really great. For those that have been joining us in Zoom, I'm sure you loved the chat. For the questions, thank you, everyone. If you're joining us on YouTube, thanks for chiming in. A couple of quick housekeeping things. Daryl, Kelly, Christine are all accessible on LinkedIn. If you're on YouTube, the links will be in the description. We'll include that out in the send out email if you joined us on Zoom. I'm going to quickly share my screen for that one last housekeeping piece. If you'd like to join us for future events, you can subscribe on YouTube and get notified. Our next big event that's coming up is our demo day. So if you'd like to see some of these soft skills put into action, and I've seen a number of our grads and recruits participating, you should come and join, because that's always fun. I have 15 minutes, 5 people in the hot seat, crown a winner. And that's happening November 5th at 12 Eastern. Daryl, Kelly, Christine, thank you so much for all your time. This